Welcome to the graveyard shift. And I also have a tendency to cheat a little bit, so it's not just slides. I used to be the fastest slide producer in the world, I guess. The two figures you see there, by the way, one is Dante of the Inferno, and the other one is Pope Gregorius II, who talked about the seven cardinal sins. I guess to continue about the seven cardinal sins, we are looking... We are all blaming the masters of the universe, as you know, and sometimes you wonder if some test would be in place to do something about them. You know, should you have a test for CEOs? Should you have a test for traders, whatever it might be? And at the moment, that's not really the case, and probably not realistic. One thing I like to say, in spite of our leader's statement, I think business school have failed. We have cranked out too many financial engineers, and we really haven't emphasized the soft skills. And it is really, I mean, the soft skills are really the hardest skills. And like you see, I mean, giving constructive feedback, talking about values, all those kind of things are very important. Instead, we have encouraged quite some narcissistic behavior. And you might even talk about psychotic implosion, I call it, you know, the way people have behaved, you know, splitting, lack of reality testing, etc. The good thing, by the way, about it is that it's nice to have this explosion because something happened. We will have a period of downsizing and things like that. But in the end, I think it has been so dramatic that people will do something. That was my experience. The problem, of course, is going to be some things, the survivor guilt and whatever it might be, and particular stress reactions. In Germany, as you know, a gentleman threw himself in front of a train, which was a dramatic way of ending. But it will be a depressive period. But in psychology, you have a number of stages. It's called denial, protest, denial, and actually the other stage, despair, detachment, and renewal. And I think we are now in the stage of despair and things like that. And maybe a much more... Maybe a deeper look should be given at executives. I mean, I'm in the business of organizational individual change, and I don't put people on the couch, but I'm trying to help people create a tipping point, because mental health is really, in a way, having a choice, and that's not, and many people don't go in that direction. Coming back to executives, as you know, in the executive world, credit goes up and garbage goes down. And maybe we should really have another look at the way leaders behave. I think what my dean just said about the acid test of a leader is how well a successor does is extremely relevant, and we haven't looked at that behavior. We have to rebuild trust. Trust is a very delicate flower. It takes a long time to get, and it's very easy to lose. But if you have trust, as you see here, you have constructive conflict resolution, you have basically commitment, people become accountable, and you have better results. This, by the way, is a terrible slide. It's a confusing chart. The kind of work we do at INSEAD, at the Global Leadership Center, is really trying to brainwash people to some extent, some small kinds of lobotomies. And actually, change is possible, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, here's, for example, Exhibit 1. I mean, he used to be a real nerd. He now has become a human being. I mean, it's not true. It's true. And also, this kind of way of looking at things is also great for teams. Teams have become much more complex these days because the high diversity of teams, gender, etc., and virtual teams, and you have to make a bigger investment in it. It means that you have to... we're now already on innovation. Sorry about my timing, ladies and gentlemen, I have to go on a little bit. But if you really want to have knowledge management, people have to trust each other. And without trust, there will be no knowledge management. It's not a question of, you know, assembling information and things like that. So we spent a lot of energy at INSEAD to really make functional teams and have people make commitments, that they create tipping points. Yeah, a few more things I like to mention about. I'm very much involved in this kind of the women-friendly organization. As you know, organizations, and you can look around, I had a Russian participant complaining about all the men he saw at the Google party. He says, right, there are not many women around. Women unfriendly, they also, I'm already past that, but I want to say something about the influence of the web. I think Sumitra has made a major contribution there to really indicate what can be done in decision making and other things. I'm interested in what's called the authentic organization, which means best places to work. And best places to work are where people have a sense of value. This, by the way, is Marcus Aurelius, the reflective practitioner, where people not only act, but also think what they're acting for, what they're acting too. And this is the Ouroboros, the self-renewing organization, an organization who tries to make it better for their children. Not like you, in this case, you see Kronos eating his children. So make it best for the next generation.